Okay, welcome everyone. I will start in 2 minutes to our course. Okay. Okay. Welcome everyone. So today we will continue to our lecture on recurrent neural networks. Today we will use PyTorch implementation. Before we have done our neural network architecture on our own, now we will use PyTorch for that. First of all, I will create a synthetic data set. So it is just some noisy sinus and some noisy cosine, as you see. So this is in one dimension, I have noisy sinus, and in another dimension, I have noisy cosine. So my data will have two dimension, and I am creating 1000 data, as you see. And when we plot it, it is like this. It is like a summit or donut because it is a sine and cosine. Okay, so if we plot them, here the x-axis is the time. So let me write it, PLT, x label time. And PLT Y label is data noisy cosine and sinus. Okay. So we have a two dimensional data, and this data is dependent on time. So because of that, since there is a dependency on time, we will use a recurrent neural network. So for the moment, as you see, y sine and y cosine, they are separate. We concatenate them here in this data. Okay. And if you look at the shape, data size. If we look at this way, it doesn't have it shape. Okay, as you see, we have 1000 observations and two features in this data. Okay, now to make prediction based on this data, we will use recurrent neural networks. Okay. So this is as you remember, let me write something again, annotate. Okay, can I draw now? Yes. So, as you remember, so we have in traditional neural network, we have an input layer, and it goes from a hidden layer, maybe another hidden layer, And after that, we have the final output layer here. So each layer is composed of neurons, as you remember. And there is a weight matrix. There is a transformation here, a linear transformation by matrix multiplication. Then we have an activation function here. And here again, we repeat that process and we have output. For the moment, I will erase this one. Okay. Okay, so, and I will draw. Okay, so at the end we have a output layer. So what we say is this is X generally, this is H hidden layer, and this is Y. Okay, so just now I will draw in a more compact way. So we have a X, we have a H, and we have a Y. So this is traditional neural network, actually. So this is H, this is Y. So okay. So this is X, H, Y in a compact version. So actually X is not just a scalar, it is a vector, as you see here. And H is not just one neuron, it is again a layer here. And Y is not a scalar, it is this one. So this is the traditional neural network with one layer, one hidden layer. And now I will erase this part, okay. Okay, so again, so this is our traditional neural network. This is the structure of our traditional neural network. And as you see, I will write again. So H is, what is H? It is a function of F X. Okay, so, or we can say HT is function of XT. And similarly, YT is also a function of, let's write this function by now, it is G of HT. Okay. So this is the traditional neural network. Okay. So, in the recurrent neural network, this is the same thing, but it is in a vertical form, as you see. So this is in horizontal form, this is vertical form. For the moment, don't see this part. If you don't see this part, actually X, H, Y, it is the same thing as the traditional neural network. But here, in the recurrent neural network, there is a recurrence here in the H part. So here, in this case, H is HT. HT is, okay, it is a function of FXT, but not just it is a function of FXT, but it is also a function of HT minus one. So this is the recurrence here. Okay. So HT is like that, and YT is again, it is the same thing. There is no change. It is the same thing as here, HD. So this is the recurrent case. In the recurrent neural networks, here. So this is the why we call it recurrent. Why? Because here, HT depends on HT minus one. Because of that, so this is the simple change in the formulation. So this is standard artificial neural networks. Okay, so this is standard artificial neural networks, ANN. We can say that this is ANN, this part. And it is there is no big change in when we just make this here. So when we make this recurrent here, this is it. This recurrence is here. Here, actually. So this is what we call as recurrent neural network. And in the recurrent neural network, the only change is this recurrence here. This is expressed in the function is like that. Okay. So this is the difference between traditional neural networks and recurrent neural networks. Okay. So this is it. Now I want to show you another clear all rules. Okay. Now I want to show you another here. You can think that this is like this. Actually, what we have, if you unfold it, you take the input, you take the previous hidden, and you obtain this new hidden. Again, you take this new input, you take the previous hidden state, HT minus one, you concatenate them, you obtain the new HT, and then you obtain YT. So if you see it in this animation, it's like that. You have a hidden state and input state. You concatenate them here, and you obtain a new hidden state. And after that new hidden state, you have an output. So this is previous hidden and input. You have a new hidden, and you have output. This is it. The formulation that I have done here. Can I take them back? Yes, I take them back. So here, as you see, first you take the input, then you take the previous hidden state. Here, let's go here. Okay, so you see hidden state and input state. You take them here. You make a function and you obtain new hidden state. This is new hidden state. And from this new hidden state, I wait for a moment. So this is your new hidden state. Okay, this is your new hidden state, and you obtain the output. From the hidden, you obtain the output. Okay, so this is what is really going on in the recurrent neural networks. Okay. So do you have questions about recurrent neural networks, the difference between RNN and ANN? I think you know it by now. We have done it also before. So if you don't have questions, I continue here. So this is our data set, which is time dependent data set. It is a two dimensional data, and we have 1000 samples. Okay. Now, if we go and look at PyTorch documentation, so this is the details of the PyTorch documentation. You can read this. I take the important part here. To PyTorch, you give a here, as you see, where is it? So here, to a RNN cell, you give hidden an input. So what should be the size of this input and hidden? So this is the important part, because the really hard part when writing a neural network model in PyTorch is to get the right dimensions. So dimensions is the key point, because all the rest is done for you. The remaining part for you as an engineer to understand the necessary dimensions. Okay, so you have to, when you use the PyTorch ready RNN, first of all, there is an input and the initial hidden state, which is H0. So what should be the size of these vectors? So here, sequence length. So input is sequence length, batch, and input size. So these are the sizes. Initial hidden state is the, if you have more than one layer, so it is number of layers times the number of directions. So if you have, this is an advanced thing. So we will think that we have only one layer and one direction. So it will be one for us. So there is a batch, there is a hidden size. So what does these things mean? Here, do I have it? No. So here I want to, for example, again, I will write. Okay. Here. So I have 1, 0, 2, 1, 0, okay, 2, and then 1. So what will be this one? So as a second, so I have a data, one dimensional data. In this case, so sorry. Okay. So, so this is my data, and I want to predict this the next data. So, what will I do? I will look previous data, and based on this previous data, I will decide the next one, the next data. I will predict the next one. Okay. So, for example, if I say that this will be about seconds length. So this is how many steps back I will look to predict this one. So this is called seconds length. So for example, if I look three steps back, then this is my seconds length is three. Okay. So this data is just it is not a vector. It is just a just one scalar followed another scalar. So this is all these data, for example, this is not a vector. So input size is here one. Okay. And batch is, so for example, I can predict, so this is the data that I have, but I can change it like this one. So here, so this is my data. I can change it to this X and Y. Okay, X and Y. Here, I can say that I have 1, 0, 2, and then I have one here. Then, so this is it, this part. After this three, I can predict this one. Okay, now in the next run, I can take this three, which is 0, 2, 1, and I can try to predict this one, which is 0. Okay, so this is like it. You can continue like this. So this is 2, 1, 0, 2, 1, 0, and after taking this 2, 1, 0, the next one is 2. Okay, so your data, actually, you transform your data into this into this format. Okay, it continues like that, and each time in the training phase, you can say that, okay, I want to give this one and predict this one. In this, if you do this, it means that you train your model with one observation only. What does this mean? Your batch will be in this case one. But if you say that I will train my model after two observations. In this case, so you give this X, so you give this two observation to your model, and you want to predict your model two. So this is your model's output, actually. Okay, so this is for example, this is your model output. So you give these two observations and you will have some prediction. So these are your predictions. In this case, you give two observations. It means that your batch size is two. So this is this will be two in this case if you give here two observations. Okay, and here sec length is three. So you know now this, what does this what is the shape is composed of? This is in this simple example, the sequence length is three, batch size is two, input size is one because it is just one dimensional vector. Okay, so I want to continue with the batch size now. So what does this batch size mean? Actually, you remember your our how we update our parameters. It is with gradient descent algorithm, if you remember. So it is like this. Repeat. Repeat. What you do is v equals v minus alpha is the learning rate. Your this is your cost function, your error, and this is your derivative. Okay. So for all your so this is your this is what we, this is how parameters or neural network learns the best parameters. So this is the gradient descent algorithm. So batch size means that you do this update operation, parameter update, after seeing two observations. After seeing these two observations here, you have some predictions, and for these predictions you have true values. So from this true, so this is y and this is y hat. So this is target value, this is your predicted value. So the difference between y and y hat is your j. J is the difference between y and y hat. So there is again. So it is just some function. Okay, I don't know. So it is just again some function. So if you, for example, if it is MSE loss, I think you remember what is MSE loss. It is just for every element wise difference, you take element wise difference, you square them, and you take the mean of all that. So here, for example, so so this is if you see, so this is MSE loss between y and y hat. So there are plenty of losses. For the moment, they are not important. The important thing is to understand what is going on. So I repeat, when batch is two, you give two observations like that with three sequences here. And you, for them, you make predictions. There are true values. The difference between them is J. And you update your parameters after seeing these two observations. This is all about batch size. Okay, then. Do you have questions?
Nope.
Okay, very nice. So this is, you also initialize your H0 because you will obtain, for example, here the next hidden state will be a function of the previous ones. But what would be the first one? So you need to initialize your H0, and after that you give it to your RNN, and you will obtain each time you will obtain both H and Y. Okay, I will erase everything. Okay, so this is it. For example, here batch size is 10. It means that you update your parameters after seeing 10 observations. Input size is 2. Hidden size is 2. So what does this mean? Okay. So x is not just one value. It is when input size is 2. It means that it is a vector with two elements. Okay. So x is like that. Hidden size is, it is not just one value. It is again a vector of two elements. Okay, hidden size is also like that. Okay. And sequence length is four. What does it mean? When you unfold this, actually you have four sequences. So there is another one here. Okay. So you have here four seconds. So seconds four means you have 4 seconds here. One, two, three, and last one is four. Okay. So to the RNN, so this is, if you remember, this is from PyTorch library, neural network module. You call RNN and you just specify input size and hidden size. You initialize your input. So input is now, it is, the shape of the input is sequence length, which is four. And batch size is, which is 10 here. And input size, this one is 2. So this is what you give. So it is just random numbers for the moment. So this is your input. And for the H0, the initial hidden state, it is, the first one is one for us. There is no other layers, just one layer and one direction. So it is simple for us and it is one. Batch size is the same thing, 10. Okay. And hidden size is 2. Okay, so to RNN, this is your model that you built here. You give the input, you give the H0, and you obtain, after this, you obtain outputs and HN. Okay, so this is Y4. Okay. So, why we have 4 in the output? Because these are our outputs. We have 4 outputs, okay? Why we have 10 in the output shape? Because it is our batch, okay? Why we have 2? This is our output size, okay? Okay then, now if we are ready, I will go to our model. Okay, so this is just initial, just to see how to build a RNN, RNN cell. Now we will build our model. Okay, so here, this is the RNN model from PyTorch. We have input size, hidden size, and output size. We define them. Okay, so this is our hidden size. We take it. This is our RNN. We define input and output size. And after that, this will output a hidden. There will be hidden here. And from that hidden, I will transform it to output size. So this is it. From here, from this hidden state, we transform it to output. Okay. So in the forward case, we take this RNN, X and H0, and we obtain these values. And after that, we, from this HN, this one, we transform it to an output state. And we also initialize our hidden states as previous example, batch and hidden size. Okay. Now, so remember our data. So this is our data, and it is 1,000 observations of two dimensional observations. Okay, from that I create our sequences. Okay, so I want to predict next x after seeing 4 previous cases. Okay. Because of that, I change my data. Here, SecondSnap is for starting from zero to the end. Each time I take four examples from my data, and after that, this is my X tensor is like that, and this is my Y tensor. Okay. So what does this mean? Here, actually, this is my data, X, data, this is my data. Here, let me show you one example, data 5. Okay. So what I want to do is, I want to predict this fifth value. Okay, based on this previous four values. So here, because of that, sec length is 4. Okay, I will not write it. Sec length is 4. Okay, from previous four observations, I want to predict the next one. Okay. So because of that, here, I have this much four observations, and based on that, I want to predict next fifth observation. Okay, so this is what I want to do. Okay, so now I will train my model. Okay, so for that, to get batches, I am using train. So this was X tensor and Y tensor. So I prepared it, as you see, from with this code. Now I give it to tensor data set. So this is my train data, and I am using also from this Torch Utils data loader. Each time this gives me batch size is 10 observations, 10 observations of from X data and 10 observations from what I want to predict. Okay, so it just simplifies to get batch of data here. Okay, and I do it number of epoch, and epoch is 100 times. What does it mean? How many times I see whole data set? So I see whole data set 100 times here. And each time I get a batch of examples, X and Y, I look to the shapes if they are okay. And I initialize the first hidden also. Each time I initialize the first hidden state, and I give this X and initial hidden state, and obtain output. Okay, so what does this mean? Let's look at here. Okay, as you see, this is our class, and it takes X and H0, and after that, finally, it returns the final output. So this is what we predict. Okay. So I get this prediction, and this is the true value, and I compare them here with this criterion. And after, so this is, I am doing it in a batch format here. So after seeing what is batch size, 10 observations, I calculate the gradients and with this backwards, and I update them. Here also, this is called gradient clipping. Sometimes in RNN, there is a problem of vanishing gradient or exploding gradient. So I just give a maximum value to the gradients. So for example, here clip is 1. So I don't want my gradients to excess this value of 1, okay? They can be, if for example, if it is 3, the gradient is 3 or 31 or 100, I just change it to 1. I don't, so this is just, it takes the mean true gradient clip. Okay, so clip is 1. So if true gradient is, for example, 45, the gradient will be 1 in this case. So it's just a regularization thing for avoiding high gradients. Okay. And each time I also look at the, my losses, how loss changes. If this model learns, I expect my the losses to decrease. And after this training, you see it learns fast, and after that it continues to drop. Okay, it means that it it is learning. And why I have 100 in the x-axis, it is because here this is number of epochs. Each actually, as you see, after each epoch I look to the loss, because of, I have 100 loss values. Okay, so this is, this is the prediction, this is the learning or training phase. Now I want to predict with this model. Is it good at predicting? Here we do it. When we want to predict, we don't want to interfere with gradients. So we say that our model is in evaluation mode. It is not in training mode. Okay, because of that, we say this RNN evaluation mode. And after that, I get every data from the in batches again, and I make predictions. And this time there is no comparing with loss, because I just want to get all the predictions, and I append them to my list here, and I concatenate them, and I turn them into NumPy. Okay. Okay, so pred shape. Okay, pred shape is, for example, we have 1,000 examples, but now we have our predictions is a little bit less because of the sequence length. We cannot make predictions for the first things. Okay. So this is our data, and this is the prediction for the data. So it understands the shape of the data, okay? And if you plot them like this, actually just one dimensions. So this is the prediction. So this is data, noisy. Noisy science. Okay. I don't write that. I should write label, I think. Okay, so this is our, so this is in the blue color we see the true data, and in the orange color we see our prediction with the our model. So it is good, it is really good at predicting. Okay, so what I want to show you now is, if you don't have questions, I want to show you an anomaly prediction, anomaly detection, sorry, with this time series data, if I can do it. So for that, what we could do is, so this is our data, and we see that there is a pattern in the data, as you see. It is like this. Okay. So if I put some anomalous data and inject some data that doesn't fit this pattern, my model should cannot predict that data. Why? Because if my model works well, it will be trained on this pattern. So if you put an anomalous data which doesn't fit to this pattern, actually my model will make a huge error on that anomalous point. So the difference between my prediction and the anomalous point will be high. It will be very high. It will be much more higher than the average error that I make for the normal data points. So if my prediction the error about my prediction is a little bit more than an average value, I can suspect about an anomalous point. So this is how can you do anomaly detection. Okay, with the time series data. But I think I will do it next week, not this time. So do you have questions? If you don't have questions, I will finish the course.
Hocam, bir şey sorabilir miyim proje hakkında?
Tabii, buyurun.
Ne zamana kadar süremiz var? Bir şey yazmıyor ama şeyde, Learn'de. Deadline nedir?
Her grubun bir sunum saati mi belirlenecek hocam? Tarihi.
Tabii. Hepsi belirlenecek. Sizin şimdiye kadar arkadaşlar, yani proje grubunuzu ve proje konunuzu biraz seçmiş olmanız gerekiyordu. Büyük ihtimalle seçmediniz. Son haftalara kalacak gibi görünüyor sizin adınıza. Ben onu ama daha ilk haftadan size söyledim. Hatta nereden proje seçebileceğinizi de söyledim. Gruplarınızı oluşturmanızı da istedim. Şöyle bir şey yapacağız. Ben haftaya da ders yapacağım. Bu şekilde devam edeceğim. Ama ondan sonraki hafta artık sizin projelerinizin ne olduğunu öğrenmek isteyeceğim sizden. Yani haftaya da şu an sizden bir şey beklemiyorum. Ama bir sonraki haftaya sizin projelerinizin ne olduğunu ve şu ana kadar ne yaptığınızı ilk kez dinleyeceğim arkadaşlar.
Tamam hocam.
Yani, tamamdır hocam.
Yani 14 Aralık'ta sizin projelerinizi belirlemiş, hatta ilk bazı çalışmaları yapmış olmanızı bekliyor olacağım. Bunu en iyisi ben size bir mail ile atayım. Bu şekilde şu an herkes anlamamış ya da duymamış olabilir. Yani 14 haftasında sizin projelerinizi dinlemek isteyeceğim arkadaşlar. Yani haftaya ders var ama 14 haftasında sizi dinleyeceğim şeklinde olacak. Proje konusunda da genel olarak Natural Language Processing ve Anomaly Detection seçmenizi önermiştim. Gene aynı şekilde. Bu çünkü RNN'ler biz gördük. Bu RNN'ler her iki senede uygulanabiliyor. Gayet rahat bir şekilde. Dolayısıyla da en azından bu şekilde bir şey yapmanızı istiyorum. Bu arada belki size bir saniye bir şey gösterebilirim. Bir saniyenizi alacağım. Okay, now I want to show you something that I'm doing. So it is called seconds-to-seconds models. So here, for example, and it's a character level seconds-to-seconds model. So this is a Turkish word. From I give to my model this Turkish word as an input, and I want to regenerate this Turkish word at the end. But it is not whole story. Actually, what I gave is a spoiled word. So, for example, here, in mostly I give the correct word pairs, but sometimes I give wrong word and I want to predict the correct word. So what is the logic here? I want to autocorrect a wrongly written word in Turkish. So this is the idea. I do it in a very simple way. So here, for example, in Turkish, we have, this is the characters that we have in Turkish. Okay. And there is a start token and there is a padding token. Okay. So here, what can I show you? So I have, so this is an auto encoder, LSTM auto encoder model. So for the moment, I will not give the details, but there is an encoder part and there is a decoder part. And as a whole, these two is a seconds to seconds model. Okay. Here, after we done the training, so here, for example, when I give for this word, for example, if I give this word, it correctly predicts the correct form içinde. So this is a very good project if you're really interested in. So for example, here, içimde, it didn't correct it, and it is good because içimde is a correct word. It is not wrongly written. So this is içişte. After this training, actually, it can learn how to correct a misspelling word. Okay. So this is another example. For example, this it corrects it, but for it is not perfect. And actually, maybe it will not work at the end very well, but I'm just trying these things. So this is, for example, here, when I give this, this is what it predicts. So it is not always true. Okay. So this is just some project that you can do. If you are interested in this project, I can talk with you. So, and by the way, this is if, for example, if our model can do this correctly, actually, we gain $1 million, actually, not we, I. Yeah, bu gerçekten çalışırsa arkadaşlar, bu gördüğünüz şey, hata düzeltme, yani çalıştığı anda sizde bu model varsa, bu model size milyon dolarların kapısını açar. Bu kadar basit yani. Eğer çalışırsa, düzgün çalışırsa. Bu konuda ciddiyim. Şöyle düşünün. WhatsApp'ta şurada burada. Evet, evet. I'm trying to fix misspelling. Yes, this is it. Bir şey yazdığınız zaman düzeltmeye çalışıyor ve daha da kötü yapıyor ve sinir bozuyor. Yani bu her şeyin ihtiyacı var. Siz işte bir arama yaptığınız zaman bazen yanlış yazıyorsunuz ama yanlış, insan olarak yanlış yazıyoruz. Yanlış yazmamıza rağmen doğru sonuç bekliyoruz. Bence çok insanca. İşte bu yanlış yazdığımız zaman aslında ne yazmak istediğimizi anlaması gerekiyor modelin. Bu şekilde. Yani bu çalışsa süper olur. Böyle bir şeyle ilgilenirseniz konuşabiliriz. Bu proje örneklerinden bir tanesi sadece. Başka sizin yapacağınız bir sürü proje olabilir. Şu aşamada bulunduğu cümle dikkate almıyor Yiğit. Ama çok haklısın. Çünkü cümleye göre, yani kontekste göre aslında şey olur. Doğru. Zaten bu size gösterdiğim şey %100 çalışan bir model değil. Yani belli ölçüde şu an, belli ölçüde çalışan bir model. Ama konteksti aynen öyle. Çok haklısın. Kontekste göre yapmak lazım. Dolayısıyla da aslında belki de böyle bir hibrit model yapmak lazım. Bu gördüğünüz model karakter seviyesinde. Bu arada onu da size birazcık göstereyim. Karakter seviyesinde ne demek? Şu burada her bir harf, gördüğünüz gibi Ali'nin A'sı Pardon, bu start token, yani bu başlangıç token'ı. Şu ise gördüğünüz gibi A. Neden A? Çünkü işte ilki A harfi, ilk harf, o yüzden o şey. Bu sadece bu bir, geri kalan sıfır. Gördüğünüz gibi burada input size 34. Çünkü işte Türkçe'de galiba 32, yani şurada biz 32 harf kullanıyoruz. Burada 32 harf kullanıyoruz. Bir tane de şey, eksik alanları tamamlama için padding, bir de start token kullanıyoruz. O yüzden 34 tane şey var. Input size 34 gördüğünüz gibi. Ve de işte bu 7, çünkü 6 harfli kelimeler için çalışıyor. Dolayısıyla da mesela bir kelime yazdığınız zaman 7 1 34 bir matris oluyor. Bu matris sadece bir kelime. Bu bir kelimeyi veriyorsunuz ve bunun aynısını modelin üretmesini istiyorsunuz bu şekilde. Böyle bir model bu. Evet arkadaşlar, bu projeler konusunda ben yani haftaya da ders anlatacağım size. Ondan sonra yavaş yavaş sizin projelerinizi dinlemeye başlayacağım ve projenizi değerlendirmeyi de en son hafta yapacağım. Ama öncesinde benimle görüşürseniz, ne yaptığınızı anlatırsanız, ki anlatmanız gerekiyor, onu da bir programlarız. Yani bir ara puan alacaksınız, bir de en son final puan alacaksınız. O şekilde bir şey yaparız herhalde. Ama siz bu projenizi hakikaten böyle düşünün, artık bir şeyler yapın ve de yani hazır kod kullanabileceğinizi söylemiştim zaten. Sadece kodun nasıl çalıştığını anlayın ve güzel, işe yarayan bir şey yapın. Mesela buradaki gibi bir şey yapabilirsiniz. Yani bir sekans to sekans modelle işte hata düzeltme gibi şeyler. Bu bir örnek. Onun dışında başka şeyler tabii ki siz de bulabilirsiniz. Ve de hazır kod kullanmanızda, tekrar altını çiziyorum, PyTorch'la ilgili hazır kod kullanmanızda herhangi bir sakınca yok. Tek gerekli olan şey, ben size sorduğum zaman cevap verebilmeniz. Eğer cevap veremezseniz çok kötü olur. Hazır kod kullanıyorsanız da o kodun ne olduğunu biliyor olmanız lazım. Nasıl çalıştığını biliyor olmanız lazım. Sizden beklentim bu. Hazır kod kullanmanızda bir sakınca yok. Tamam arkadaşlar. Başka sorunuz var mı?
Yok.
Peki. Teşekkür ederim o zaman. Kendinize iyi bakın.
Teşekkür ederim.
İyi günler.